angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son.
Well, welcome to our Christmas Eve service. Tonight we've come out of the hurried and the harried world. We hope that you've had a great day. But we come tonight to have some focus and to have some calm in the house of God. Tonight we're going to sing the Christmas story. Tonight we're going to read the Christmas story from Scripture. We're going to listen, we're going to watch, we're going to sing, we're going to light a candle, and we'll have an opportunity to commune as well. And I just want to commend you for being here tonight. In the midst of everything that's going on, you want to prepare your heart, your soul, for the coming of Jesus as we celebrate that. So tonight, we're going to slow down. We're going to remember. We're going to reflect, refocus on what we're celebrating. And we're going to do that as individuals, as families, and collectively as a church family as well. Would you bow with me and let's pray? Father, we want to, again, pause and thank you for this opportunity. We want to make the very most of it. And God, for some of us, it's been just a really hectic day, and that's on top of some other hectic days. And so we're thankful now for the opportunity to pause, to say thank you, to remember your love for us. Be with each one as we celebrate tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. From Luke, the first chapter, we read these words. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, to a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." And Mary, she was greatly troubled at these words, and she wondered what kind of a greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You'll be with child and will give birth to a son. And you're to give him the name Jesus. And he'll be great, and he'll be called Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Amen? Would you stand with us and let's sing together?
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. The Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. hearts hills and plains. Repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy.
He rules the world.
He rules the world with truth and grace. And makes the nations prove the glory. Of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
Hark the herald.
Excelsis Deo.
shall see today. Please be seated.
I'm going to be reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. It says this. It says, "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them."
Child that you delivered was did you know the old baby boy who gives sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know the old baby boy would calm a storm with his head? Did you know the old baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God.
Thank you.
Let's all sing that first verse together. Sing, away in a manger.
Away in a manger, no crib for a bed. The little Lord Jesus lay down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
Sing, be near me, Lord Jesus.
Be near me, Lord Jesus. Need to stay close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care and take us to heaven to live with thee
there. Continuing in Luke chapter 2. Yeah. Continuing through Luke chapter 2, it says, in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them. The glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news with great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born the day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that they had been told them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them.
To certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night. There was so deep. Thank you.
Take a deep breath. Don't know what to say when I look in your eyes. You made the world before I was born. Here I am holding you in my arms tonight. Noel, Noel, Jesus, sorry man. Christmas, the night that God became a baby boy. Someday you're gonna go home again. You'll leave your spirit and flood the world with joy. You'll be here. I'm holding you so near. I'm staring into the face of my Savior, King and Creator. You could have left me on my own, but you're
reading from Isaiah chapter 7 and chapter 9. Then Isaiah said, "Listen well, you royal family of David. Isn't it enough to exhaust human patience? Must you exhaust the patience of my God as well? All right then, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen."
I wonder what it would be like to be born in a manger.
Yeah. Wonder whatever happened to baby Jesus.
He grew up.
What? Wait. So you're saying that the baby Jesus Christmas story is the same as the adult walk on water Jesus?
Yeah. Thanks, honey.
Wow, I just never really put the two concepts together. Wonder what happened to that guy, huh?
He went to the cross.
That's the same guy?
Yeah.
So what you're saying is baby Jesus is the same as cross Jesus?
Yeah. I mean, there's some time in there, right? I mean, he grew up, he taught people, he lived a perfect life. He died on the cross and came back to life, and, you know, now he lives in our hearts.
That's the same guy? The Jesus that lives in our hearts? Okay, I was really... Oh, wow. Okay, I never really put all those guys together, you know?
Only one guy.
I tell you this. There's an idea. Maybe we stop just making Christmas all just this once-a-year isolated thing, but we make it an ongoing story about the salvation in our hearts and lives. Up top.
That's the idea.
Well, yes, there is some confusion about Christmas. We have Jesus, baby Jesus, we got Santa, we got Rudolph with his nose so bright. And so there's confusion because not everybody puts together the connection between baby Jesus and cross Jesus. But in some sense, most think that the night that Jesus was born was a holy night. But it's confusing because of this scene. The scene that we see, we have a manger, we have baby Jesus, we have the Virgin Mary, we have Joseph. Cows are lowing, whatever lowing is. But think about this scene for just a moment. We have a teenage girl who's pregnant by the Holy Spirit. We have her and her fiance traveling by donkey. They are going for 90 miles, a 9-month pregnant woman on a donkey for 90 miles. When my wife Julie gave birth, I took her a mile and a half to a hospital on a Toyota Corolla, and that was rough enough, okay? Can you imagine a donkey? I mean, don't, right? But finally they arrive and there's no place to stay, so there's no inn, right? Joseph, did you think about reservations? Did you think about that? But how about a barn with animals? Now, Mary's giving birth in this not-so-good environment. It's the middle of the night. It's unsterile. They're screaming. I'm sure Mary's screaming. Maybe Joseph is screaming. Probably both are screaming because the baby's coming. And there's no epidural and no angel going, just breathe, just breathe. But then all of a sudden, it happens, right? God wrapped in a baby. Can you imagine this? God, this is you wrapped as a baby? A baby that eats and sleeps, a baby that cries and fills up diapers, you know, that kind of baby. I mean, talk about downsizing. Paul in Philippians chapter 2, he says, Jesus made himself nothing, humbles himself, becomes obedient to death, even death on a cross. So God shows up and he puts skin on, right? He's touchable, he's approachable. Amazingly, the omnipresent one now downsizes to the confines of a human womb. The omnipotent one becomes a helpless baby, needing to be fed and nursed and burped. The omniscient one now has to learn to read and to write and do arithmetic. And you go, why? Why all of that? Well, Jesus becomes nothing so that we can become something. Jesus makes this incredible deal. He says, hey, give me all of your sins, I'll give you all of my righteousness, and then we'll call it even. Okay? And that's just amazing to think about, that concept. He came to our place, and then he takes our place, and then he invites us to his place. That's why they refer to that night as a holy night. Our Christmas series this year has been the Advent. The word simply means coming. We do a lot to get ready for Christmas. We've gone Christmas shopping. We've got gifts. We've got parties to go to. There's all kinds of family events. But we said this year what we're going to do is we're not just going to do all of that stuff, but we want to make sure that we're preparing our heart and soul for the coming of the celebration of Jesus to this earth. That's what we want to do. Now, I don't want to upset some of you, but we don't know for sure that Jesus was born on December 25th, okay? Not for sure, but if it makes you feel better, there's a 1 in 365 chance, okay? But he was born, we definitely know that, but we really don't know the date. About 300 years after Jesus was born, the church wants to set a day. They want to put it on the calendar. They want to be able to celebrate, acknowledge, to remember the birth of Jesus. And they settle on December 25th. And you say, well, why that day? Well, it's the middle of the winter solstice. December 25th at that point was identified as the darkest night, the shortest day, the darkest day. And so December 25th is the day that we celebrate the light and the life, the light and the life. And then on Christmas Eve at midnight, December 24th, they would lit the Christ candle, to remember that Jesus is the greatest presence of all. Remember that his presence is here with us. He becomes that, right? He's the light and life in the darkest, in the coldest moments. And again, that makes sense. This Christmas during the Advent, we've looked at Christmas songs, and tonight it's O Holy Night, written 150 years ago. A priest asked a poet to write a poem from Luke chapter 2. Now, this poet is not a Christ follower. In fact, he's kind of known as a hellraiser, but he's a good poet, okay? And he writes this poem, and then he asks his friend, who's also not a Christian, to put some music to it. Now, the song becomes very, very popular until they figure out who wrote this song. Now, everybody wants to shut this song down, but they can't do it. It's too popular. Now, I don't think that detracts from the song. Rather, what I think it does is it reminds me about the good news, that the good news is so powerful, it works through imperfect people. Actually, imperfect people like you and me as well. I want to zero in on one phrase from verse 1 in that song, and the phrase is, a thrill of hope. A thrill of hope. Anyone need hope this Christmas? A thrill of hope. The weary world rejoices. Now, let's be honest, we get weary. Some of you are weary tonight. Now, weary doesn't just mean tired. The definition of weary means a resistance to experience anything more. A resistance to experience anything more. Like, it's done. I've had enough. I can't take anything more. I can't take it much longer. That is the word weary. To better understand this basic word about being weary and being tired and the difference between those two. I found that emojis sometimes help. Some people like to express their emotions through emojis, clarifies. So here's the sleepy emoji. You see the sleepy emoji, all right? And then after that, we have the tired emoji, tired. But I want you to see, if you Google weary emoji, this is what comes up, all right? Take a look at this one. That's weary, all right? That's how a lot of us feel, even tonight. We're just tired. Tired of things not going our way. We don't feel like I can take it any longer. I think it's the right word that accurately describes our world today. It's a weary world. I mean, we're overwhelmed, and there's so much anxiety. There's economic uncertainty. There's wars. There's terrorism. We're weary of division and politics. Relationships seem to be messed up. Sometimes our families are strained, and we're struggling. We're fighting just to stay above water. Above water, both emotionally and well as spiritually. I think we know well the word weary world. Weary world. What I love about this song, though, is it says there's a thrill of hope. A thrill of hope for everyone who feels weary. Anyone who feels like they've had enough. No doubt there's chaos that first holy night. But the thrill of hope is there that they've waited for so long. The Messiah is present. Hope is born. Born. A thrill of hope. And suddenly the weary world does what? The weary world rejoices. My prayer is that if any of you have the weary world in you, that you experience a thrill of hope this Christmas. That inside your weary world, you find faith to rejoice. Why? How? Because even in the chaos of night, there's a new and glorious morn. Please know that because hope is born, because Jesus leaves heaven to rescue our weary soul, that the soul feels its worth. That's what the song communicates. The soul feels its worth. And there's such good news tonight because so many of us struggle with feelings of worthlessness. Culture assigns worth based upon our appearance or our performance or how many points we score or whether or not our grades are good or we got the promotion or we got a degree, whatever it might be. And then when things don't go very well, our appearance begins to fade or we lose our job or the grades aren't what we thought they were going to be, all of a sudden we feel a bit worthless. But Jesus lets you and he lets me know our value when he leaves heaven itself and he comes to this earth and then he goes to the cross. So tonight, right, in the nights to come, think about that holy night. But please remember what happens the next day. The sun comes up, hope is born, Jesus arrives. And again, Isaiah, what Dustin read earlier, we recognize that the baby grows up and he's called Wonderful Counselor, someone to guide me, Mighty God, someone to rescue me. Everlasting Father, someone to provide for me. The Prince of Peace, someone to calm me when it doesn't seem like I can become calm. Jesus, the thrill of hope, right? Means that you and I get to live. It's a thrill of hope in a weary world. It's a thrill of hope and all we see is darkness. It's faith that a new morning is coming after, especially after the chaos of night. It's been said that for 40 years, a person can live 40 days or so without food, about 8 days or so without water, about 4 minutes or so without oxygen, but a person can only live for a few seconds without hope. And yet so many people try to survive on a hope-deprived life. They look for other things to fill their hope and to put their hope in. Many people put their hope in the wrong gift. Some of you think this year's Christmas gift is going to change your world. Hey, I'm telling you, a chia head, no matter who it is, all right? That's not going to change your world, all right? It's not the game changer you think it's going to be. Verse 1, though, reminds us of the reason for our hope, and I want you to hear this tonight. Long lay the world in sin and error, pining until he appeared. That word pining simply means yearning, right? We're longing for relief from guilt. Because of all our sin, we're released. We want to be released from the fear of death. So Jesus, he comes and reminds us that God gives us hope for eternal life. That you and I are lost without God, without hope. But again, hope is born. God takes on human flesh. And the thrill of hope is that God loves you so much, he loves me so much, that he comes to rescue us. Some of you tonight might be in the chaos of night. You're in a weary world. The baby's coming. Everybody's screaming. There's no epidural. The cows are lowing. Oh, no. All right? But in the middle of this weary world, in the darkness of the night, remember that Jesus is born. Jesus is born for you. You have hope in the midst of chaos. Jesus is here. You have hope in the night. For yonder breaks a new and glorious morning. So don't lose the thrill of hope that Jesus brings. Hope is born for every one of us, no matter how weary you are tonight. Not one of us needs to be in the dark. This Christmas Eve, Jesus wants to give you the gift of rest. He wants you to have rest for your weary soul. He wants your soul to feel its worth. He wants you to be able to rejoice no matter what kind of circumstances you find yourself in. We have great news, right? We have great joy. Hope is born. Soon, light will transform this room. I think that's a reminder that Jesus steps into the chaos of night. He steps into darkness. In our chaos, he is here. In our darkest time, he is here. He's the one who brings the light. And now the glow of light will come, and it's going to come as you look around from all kinds of people. Adults and children alike will shine, reminding us that Jesus is the one who transforms every one of us who call on his name. He does it for everyone. Shirley and Julie are going to sing a song that's a tradition. Jesus leaving and coming to that world was definitely a holy night. But you have to understand that holy night led to another holy night. And the last verse that they sing is a combination both about his birth and his death. It's the juxtaposition of the reality of the hope that you and I have because Jesus was a baby, but Jesus also grows up and goes to the cross. Take a look.
Stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul my weary
temple veil was torn, he said, "Tonight, child, you shall be with me in paradise. Oh, tonight,
to close out the service now by singing Silent Night. At the same time, we're going to light each other's candles, and we'll see and remind ourselves the light of the world, Jesus, comes into the darkness. Then there's a simple time of communion. As you leave, you can grab the communion cups. You can come back in here, go to the cross, go to one of the icons. You can go in the lobby. We'd ask that you would leave here quietly so people who do want to commune in here can do that. Some might be prepared to give a gift, and you can do that as well in the boxes or into a manger. Again, we're going to sing that night, that silent night. At the third verse, we're going to lift high our candles, signifying Jesus. Let's sing.
Silent night,
of God. Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams, radiant beams from thy holy face with the dawn, with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus is Lord. Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Oh, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth.
Would you lift high your candles? And would you just take a moment to look around? Jesus, the light of the world, this is what we're celebrating this night. You can extinguish your candles now. Again, you're going to be dismissed with time of communion. On behalf of Northwest Christian Church, I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. We do have a service tomorrow at 10 a.m., completely different than this. And then we have a 4, 5:30, and 7, identical to this. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for the gift of Jesus. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for each one who is weary, recognizing that we have the thrill of hope because of Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Have a great evening.